Hi and welcome to Nursing School Explained. Today we'll take a closer look at cerebral palsy. So cerebral palsy is a chronic and non-progressive neuromuscular disorder. Keep in mind, whenever there's something going on with the muscles, there's usually nerve involvement as well, because without the nerve impulse, the muscles won't be receiving the signal to actually contract and relax. So cerebral palsy leads to difficulty controlling the muscles, and there might also be possible comorbidities that affect the patient cognitively, as well as their hearing, speech, and vision, and then they might also have seizures. So what causes cerebral palsy? There's been many discussions as to the causes, but there seem to be related factors. That there's some damage that occurs to the brain, whether that's prenatally, during the birthing process, or in the postpartum period. So low birth weight infants are at higher risk for developing cerebral palsy, as well as multiple gestation infants. So twins, triplets, quadruplets are usually at a higher incident for being premature. And that is also, multiple gestation is also related to infertility treatment. So there seems to be a relationship there. And then certainly premature infants, a lot of times they suffer from hypoxia during the birthing process, or they just don't develop normally because they just don't have the time to spend in utero for normal neuromuscular development. And then in the prenatal period, maternal infections can also lead to cerebral palsy, and those would include any of these infections that we want to keep away from pregnant women, which would be rubella, German measles, cytomegalovirus, as well as chickenpox. Now, neonatal jaundice is also linked to cerebral palsy because of the buildup of that bilirubin in the system and its effect on the brain and the brain development. And then certain maternal conditions are also linked to cerebral palsy, which would be thyroid disorders or seizures specifically. So think about if the maternal metabolic rate is not controlled well, that can have effects on the fetus if there are thyroid disorders. And then certainly if the mother suffers from seizures, so maybe she suffers a seizure while she is pregnant, that can cause some hypoxia in the infant and then abnormal brain development. And then in the intrapartum period, if there's a placental abruption, so all of a sudden the placenta detaches from the uterus causing bleeding, which is usually a medical emergency and that infant has to be delivered emergently, or if the umbilical cord is tangled in any way, or maybe around the baby's neck, that will lead to fetal hypoxia, and that is also related to the development of cerebral palsy. Now, signs and symptoms of cerebral palsy might be, again, from mild to pretty severe, and again, it's usually neuromuscular. So initially, it might be detected by the persistence of primitive reflexes. So that might be the rooting reflex persists past its normal time period, or the palmar grasp reflex, or any of those primitive reflexes that we typically assess for in newborns are there in the newborn, but then maybe at 3 or 4 or 6 months they persist. So that should be a question mark, that there's something going on in their development, as well as delayed gross motor movements. So if the patient is expected to start walking around the age of 1 year old and they are just now 18 months and there's absolutely no intention or no ability for this infant to start walking, that should be a red flag that there might be some cerebral palsy going on. As well as any kind of abnormal muscle tone that can lead even to spasticity. So that will usually mean that there is extreme contraction of certain muscles, and when you can usually see that in the extremities, that will lead to the patient not being able to extend or flex their extremities in a way that they would normally, as well as ataxia, so difficulty in gait. If there is neuromuscular problems, we can detect that. Patient might have seizures, they might be having signs and symptoms of ADHD, as well as sensory impairment, as we discussed over here, hearing, speech, and visual, and then speech and swallowing difficulties that can be detected. Diagnostic testing always involves EEG to see exactly the brain waves and measure those to see how is the communication happening from one side of the brain to the other once that impulse is received. CT and MRI imaging studies of the brain to check for any underlying causes, maybe tumors or malformations or signs of any abnormal development there. As well as BNP, we always want to make sure that we check basic electrolyte panels because we know certain electrolytes are in charge of muscle control. So if there's an abnormality there, that might be the cause. We certainly want to take a thorough history addressing all these prenatal, intrapartum, and postpartum conditions that might have led to cerebral palsy, as well as a very detailed neurologic exam, head to toe, including all cranial nerves, and then genetic testing will be done as well. Excuse me. Treatment usually is a multidisciplinary approach, because many parts of the body are affected. So for the physical component, there will be an orthopedic surgeon, an orthopedist involved, hopefully physical therapy. And then if there's cognitive impairment, neurologists might be involved, as well as maybe a neurosurgeon, as well as a speech therapist, an occupational therapist, and many more disciplines that can help this child achieve optimal function. And because the cause of this is basically abnormal muscle tone and spasticity, because it's this chronic but non-progressive neuromuscular disorder. So this is something that's not going to get worse over time. Typically the spasticity is what it is, and then it is treated as such. And a very effective treatment is intrathecal baclofen. And baclofen is a muscle relaxant, and intrathecal means that it is injected in directly into the spinal cord to cause the relaxation of the muscle, the nerve roots right there, so that the muscles kind of relax and are not so spastic, causing all the signs and symptoms and maybe some difficulty walking if the lower extremities are effective. Now, benzodiazepines sometimes are given as well for spasticity and seizures, but keep in mind benzodiazepines have a high risk for dependency, so we always want to be extra careful with those. And Botox injections. Remember, Botox basically relax the muscle, they make it not so spastic, and so they can relax it or basically kind of freeze the muscle, and then that also helps with spasticity. So thank you for watching this video on cerebral palsy. Please also see the other videos that refer to pediatric neurological disorders such as spina bifida and hydrocephalus in the pediatric playlist of my channel, Nursing School Explained. Leave any comments down below. I'm always happy to review those. And if you have any specific topic you would like me to cover, please put that in the comments as well, and I'll be happy to address that. Thanks for watching.